here's an example of hypothesis testing, but now what we're going to do is use the p-value hypothesis testing. So really what I want you to understand is two different methods, the classical hypothesis testing method and the p-value hypothesis testing method. So maybe watch the classical hypothesis testing video first, and then this one, the p-value hypothesis testing, and I'll be able to reference back and forth between the differences. Okay, anyways, for p-value hypothesis testing, things start out kind of the same. I got a different example here. Now we're talking about you own a coffee shop, you sell 500 coffees or somethings per day with a standard deviation of 120. Then we get a sample of 64 rainy days, and on those days, the coffee sales increased to 525. And we will want to test the claim that rainy weather affects coffee sales with 95% confidence. So kind of like we did in the last problem, we'll go through and find all the pertinent information. So this 500 here is talking about a population average, but instead of using mu, we'll use mu naught because we want to save mu for something else later. The standard deviation of 120, note that that's talking about the population standard deviation if you read this. It's not the standard deviation for the sample, but for all coffee sales. So this is sigma, that's equal to 120. We have a sample of 64 rainy days, so that's our value for n. And our sample average, how much we sell on those days, is 525. That's x bar. We want 95% confidence, so that tells us that alpha equals 0.05. And then mu is the population average. Population average, coffee sales. But not just population average coffee sales for all days. We just want the population average coffee sales on rainy days. So what I'm getting at here is we don't want the population for all sales, but we also don't want the average for coffee sales just on these 64 days. We want to know the population average, so we're talking about all days here, but all rainy days. So if we could somehow figure out how much we'd sell on every single possible rainy day, the population average, that's what mu would be. All right, and if you have those, we can start stating our null and alternative hypothesis. Very similar to what we did up here. Up there, we said that mu is equal to mu naught was our null hypothesis, H naught. Here it's same thing, mu equal to mu naught. Our null hypothesis will be that mu is equal to 500. Our alternative hypothesis will be a little bit different. It's not different because we're doing p-value hypothesis testing. It's different because of this word right here. Up here I said test the claim that HGH increases home runs, which is what told us to put a greater than sign right here, made it a right-tailed test. Down here, I just say that it affects coffee sales, so it either can increase or decrease coffee sales. In other words, our alternative hypothesis, our claim, is that mu does not equal mu naught. This is what's called a two-tailed test. And again, you can have one or two-tailed test for p-value or for classical method. I just wanted to illustrate both, so I put one in each of the two examples. But the difference between p-value and classical, we have not seen yet. This everything I've done so far would work for either type of problem. All right, now shape, center, spread. These are also going to be identical to how we did them under the classical method. Shape, center, spread. The shape is approximately normal because it always is. But we'll want to justify why. When we're talking about quantitative data, our criteria will be that n is greater than or equal to 30. N is 64 in this case. Perfect. Greater than or equal to 30. Our central limit theorem says that the sampling distribution is approximately normal. When I go to draw my picture later, it's a pretty poor one. Try that again. Maybe that's better. I draw my picture, I want it to have this shape that we've seen so much of, this approximately normal shape. Center, just like above, our center is going to be mu naught. And just like above, what's really going on here is our center is mu, but we're assuming our null hypothesis is correct. We're assuming that mu equals 500. So because of this 500 value right here, We're going to put our center here at 500. And again, we're going to want to know both x values and z values. So maybe I'll put a 0 down here. This is the x value. This is the z value. Our spread, again, just like above, we're going to use the standard deviation of the sampling distribution, which is sigma over root n, which in this case is, what, sigma was 120, and n was 64. So that's 120 divided by 8, which is 15, 16. Oh, I better do it on a calculator. 120 divided by 8 is equal to 15. Might have been what I said. I don't remember. Shape, center, spread. Nice. Now we can draw our picture. What's different? For the first time, we're going to see what's different between the p-value method and the classical method. What's different is that in this step last time, we created these rejection regions in blue here. We looked at alpha and created our rejection region. We're not going to create rejection regions down here. There are no rejection regions. Kind of nice. Cuts out a step. Makes the drawing the conclusion a little bit harder, arguably. But there's no rejection regions. We don't need to figure that out. We don't need to use inverse norm. We don't have to do any of that stuff. P-value is a little bit easier. All we got to do is figure out where our 525 is. Okay, I guess that's somewhere out here. So just like we figured out where our 29 was, we're going to figure out where our 525 was. The way we figured out where our 29 was by going under stat, and then tests, and then z-test. Gonna do that again. Again, we have statistics. Mu naught is equal to 500 now. Sigma is equal to 120. That's not this, where'd it go? It's not this 15, it's this 120. Be careful there. X bar is 525. Value for n we said was 64. And now our alternative hypothesis is that mu does not equal mu naught. It's this first one. We'll have to change that. It's important that you change that. It's not as important in classical, but it's very important in p-value. So when we go down to calculate here, it's going to give us some information. What it's going to tell us is that the z-score for this 525 is 1.67. In other words, this is 1.67 here. And the p-value... So maybe I should define p-value. P-value is the probability. Probability, I'm spelling wrong. Of a result this extreme. So what I mean by that, I want to go back and reference this problem here. The p-value in this problem is the area above this value of 29. I should have written it down. Something really small. It's the area above 2.83. It was like 0.00 something. Really, really small here. It's just the area above 29 because we're doing a right-tailed test. P-value down here is a little bit trickier because it's a two-tailed test. It's the probability of getting either a result out here, the green shaded region, or a result out here. So it's either you're above 1.67 or below negative 1.67. That's only because it's two-tailed. If we did the p-value method on this example, it would have just been the area to the right of 29 because it was a one-tailed test. But down here, since it's two-tailed, our p-value shows up in two different spots. And our p-value is equal to 0.09. In other words, this total area from this region and this region is 0.096. So what does that tell you? Well, really what you do is you compare your p-value to alpha. And that's how you draw your conclusion. So maybe I'll write my conclusion and then explain a little bit more about where it came from. Conclusion. Because we're doing p-value, our conclusion will look a little bit different. We'll say because our p-value is greater than alpha, there is not sufficient evidence to reject the null hypothesis. It's tempting to go further. You want to say something else about the claim, about the alternative hypothesis. You don't. We're not saying that our alternative hypothesis is right or wrong. We're not doing anything. All we're saying is that we don't have enough evidence to conclude that our null hypothesis is wrong. The analogy that people use is the null hypothesis is on trial. And we're not saying that the null hypothesis is guilty. No, we're not saying that the null hypothesis is innocent down here. All I'm saying is that it's not guilty. There's not enough evidence to find it guilty. I'm not saying it's innocent. It's just not guilty. Anyways, the difference is up here, if your test statistic is in the rejection region, you reject the null hypothesis. And if your test statistic is not in the rejection region, you say there is not enough evidence to reject the null hypothesis. Down here, if your p-value is larger than alpha, then there is not enough evidence to reject the null hypothesis. If your p-value is less than alpha, there is sufficient evidence to reject your null hypothesis and conclude that whatever your claim is. And the way that works in the picture is, because we're doing a two-tailed test here, if I were to set up my rejection region, the total area of my rejection regions would have been 5%. So we're not actually setting up rejection regions, but if I were to do that, then I would have made them maybe in blue and their total area would be 5%. And since their total area is only 5%, less than this 9%, they must have started further out to the right than 1.67 and further out to the left than -1.67. Because they have less area above and below them, they must have started further out. So had I made rejection regions, my test statistic would not have fallen in my rejection region. So really what's going on is your conclusions are the exact same. It doesn't matter which method you'll use. You should always draw the exact same conclusion. It's just different ways of looking at it. I think this one makes a little bit more sense intuitively because if it's in the rejection region, you reject. Sure, I can remember that. Whereas down here, you have to remember to compare your p-value to alpha. And if your p-value is greater than alpha, you don't reject. And if your p-value is less than alpha, you do reject. And it'll take a little while to see how those are equivalent statements logically. But once you get the hang of it, and you can do them both one-tailed and two-tailed, this stuff will make a little bit more sense to you. But I think at this point, that's about all you need to write. Draw a picture kind of like this, and then make your conclusion here. But the thing I really want to emphasize is the reason that we had a shaded region on both sides here was because this was a two-tailed test, not because this was a p-value example. If you have a two-tailed test, you have stuff on both sides. If you have a one-tailed test, you just have stuff on one side. And that's true whether you're doing the classical method or the p-value method. I just want to make sure I illustrated one of each type. So it just turned out that p-value ended up being two-tailed. But what you might want to do is go back and redo both of these examples, but do this one using the p-value method and do this one using the classical method and make sure you get the same conclusions. And if you get the same conclusions, then that's good. You're starting to understand these methods. I think that's enough on this. That's the end of this video.